taking the time to come out. Before we get started with our official agenda, I'd like to ask Commissioner Lashley if he would give an invocation.
Sure. Let us pray. Our gracious Heavenly Father, we pause at this time to acknowledge that you are our God and we are your people. We just thank you for all that you do for us. We just ask you to be with these commissioners this evening and as we do the people's business. Be with us and guide us in everything we say and do. In your holy name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Hey, we have four people who have signed up for public comments. The first one is Laura Roselle.
Good evening, commissioners. I'm Laura Roselle. I live in Burlington. I'm a mom. I'm also a political science professor at Elon. When I came before you a month ago, I asked some questions about the implementation of 287G in Alamance County, and I'm here tonight to ask when the community will get some answers to these questions and to the numerous additional questions that have arisen since. It's really interesting that the more I find out about the program, the more concerned I actually become. Specifically related to the questions asked last month, I'd like to know if citizens will be included on the steering committee that assesses the implementation of the program, and I'd like to know about the complaint mechanism associated with the program. Just so you know, over the past year, the ACLU and the UNC Law School Immigration and Civil Rights Clinic have developed a complaint mechanism. It's already established and available for distribution. And before anyone starts bad-mouthing Chapel Hill, I'd just like to remind the commissioners that the University of North Carolina at Chapel Hill is one of the finest universities in the entire country. We should be very, very proud of it and listen carefully and with open minds to the reports and studies from its extremely talented faculty and staff. Now, new questions that have come up while the community has waited for any kind of response from the commissioners include, obviously, first, why it's taken so long for some response, and then why are some commissioners attending a partisan meeting outside of the county, orchestrated by people who are not interested in facts or ideas with which they disagree. In fact, associated with what I consider to be a hate group, and presenting this as some kind of information or ICE workshop or immigration workshop. The model to be presented, as I understand it, is Prince William County. But if you think this issue has been divisive in Alamance County, it is nothing to what has happened in Prince William County, and I'd be happy to share the research I've done about that and how it has split apart the community in Prince William County, and we just do not need that. So I would be extremely wary of taking that as a model. Another question, why isn't our first priority sustaining and building community policing? That is where you're going to get the most effective law enforcement, when you have the people trusting law enforcement. Instead, we're undermining trust for law enforcement with our current implementation of 287G. Others, I'm sure, will bring up additional questions, so I'm going to leave that to them. But I have one final comment. I value diversity because diversity encourages innovation, it increases economic opportunities, it expands our minds to new ideas, and it pushes us to be open, thoughtful, and kind. And diversity then makes us stronger. Stereotyping any people as having certain characteristics is dangerous and hurts us all. I live in Alamance County, and we live in Alamance County. Right here, this is our home. We're not from outside of here. And we want it to be a place where people are treated fairly and humanely. All people, not just some. We want the laws to be applied equally, not selectively, and we want commissioners who are willing to listen with open minds to differences of opinion about whether or not we should be involved in a federal program that has had serious and damaging consequences in our county. And we would like our questions answered. Thank you.
Let me ask you a question.
Yes,
if,
Mr. Walsh.
If the 287G is so damaging, tell us what the damage is. What do you people not expect us to abide by the law? What laws do you want us to enforce, or do you want us to enforce any of them?
Mr. Lashley, that first of all, the confrontational tone is probably not necessary, because I think that the community could come together and really discuss.
I just ask you a question. I don't need an education. I just ask you, What laws?
Mr. Lashley, I'm a citizen in this county, a resident in this county, and I should be treated with respect.
I am treating you with respect.
I do not believe that.
Do you not, you come down here and ask us questions, and all those questions have been answered.
You're an elected official, sir.
All those questions have been answered by the news media from people here with different ideas. And I'm just saying, apparently you haven't read the paper.
I read the paper every day. I read the blogs too, sir. And there's not been an official response from this commission. This program has hurt our community because it is divisive.
How has it hurt?
People are divided.
All we're doing, all the sheriff is doing is enforcing the laws.
If you would like me to answer a question.
Now, if they want to come here illegal, that's fine. But if they break the laws while they're here illegal, they should suffer the same consequences that everybody in this room. If I get caught driving drunk, I'm going to get a ticket and I'm going to be put in jail. And anybody here illegal should be included in the same laws.
It's clear that you're not open to having a conversation about this because you've just run over.
I'm having a conversation. You come down here and you lambast us for enforcing the laws that's on the books. I don't know what the problem is. We want you to abide by the same laws that we abide by. Your group.
Okay, let's go to the next speaker. It's Felix. I can't read the last name, Felix.
Commissioners, my name is Felix. I am a Alamance resident attending ACC. I only had two questions. What's happening to the car's property value if these people are getting detained, deported, and they can't get it back? Where's the money going? Who is in charge of all that? And is it going to be made public?
The cars that are taken?
The cars that are impounded from these individuals who are being deported, detained, that they can't get them. Where those cars going? Where's the money being made from those cars, those properties, or anything that might be able to sell? Where's the money going?
Sheriff, can you answer that question for us?
I give a DWI. The state sees them their second DWI. The state sees themselves at the public auction. The rest of them, are returned back to the people that's got them financed, unless it's a drug seizure. If it's a drug seizure, then the federal state government one can take those cars and order them sold or turn them over to law enforcement to be used in an undercover capacity or be sold and the money go to the school system.
I think the other issue was also that it has been brought to my attention by some residents here in Alamance of them having cases where the officer who takes the car away gives them a handwritten note to go to a certain spot to pick up the cars. And when they get there, they can't get released because they have a contract with the sheriff department. And so they're making them go on a wild goose chase back and forth, and they can't get the cars out. And we have at least 7 cases that we have heard.
If he can give us names, I can look it up and I can tell him why the cars were released or weren't released or what happened to the cars. But just making accusations, there's nothing they do. I need some names of people that had the cars seen, and I'll be glad to look the information up and give it to you.
And we'll go ahead and work on the list on that. We'll go ahead and work on a list on that and see anything else that we might need to see where's the problem going on with 27G and other stuff.
Sheriff would be happy to furnish all that information.
Thank you.
That's one of the problems that I see in these meetings, and certainly dialogue is good for community, and there's no problem. But when folks come up and say, well, I know of 7 cases of this, or I know that this occurred, there are certain guidelines and ways that certainly you can report if you feel like something has happened that maybe in your mind it shouldn't have happened. Or right there is the man that's sitting there, the sheriff of this county, and you can walk into his office at any time and report a problem. But when there are generalities made rather than specifics at the time, then that makes it really tough. And I'll bring up a perfect example, and that was of the 3 children that allegedly were left out on the interstate. And it was more than a month that went by, that, and then the report comes trickling down. If I'm wrong, tell me, but I think it was from Maryland. And then the sheriff goes back and has to go back and do what he can as far as an investigation, and finds that, lo and behold, the Highway Patrol, they checked that street. That car was not there. More than likely, that man got in that car and left the scene after that officer left with those kids. But there was not a report made to the sheriff at the time. So again, we're looking at things that aren't specific, and there needs to be specific complaints. And if you have complaints, please go to the sheriff. He'll sit there and he will take those complaints. Thank you.
Okay, Brian Niehaus.
Commissioners, thank you very much. Commissioner Engel, I'll address your comment first.
Yes, sir.
287G is a relatively new and complicated program. You have a lot of citizens of this county who are very concerned with its implementation. There's a lot of uncertainty that surrounds this program. So that I think it would be a good idea to cut citizens some slack as they ask questions that are sometimes exploratory. I suspect that as we learn more, we who oppose 287G will be able to come up with some very specific questions. A month ago, we asked two specific questions. Commissioner Lashley mentioned that there were responses in the media, and I think he even also mentioned that the responses were varied. I would say that this issue is sufficiently important, and you representing us and the members of this county deserve better communication than that we've had in the past. So that the issue I really wanted to talk about was a practical one. How can we submit questions to you in a way that's less than a fleeting comment at a meeting? Is there a way we can submit these questions to you, say, on an internet site, so that we have our names and our addresses attached to the questions? The questions are there for all to see. And then you, as a body, officially, can draft a response and maybe have the head of county government make sure that response is posted, so that we can maybe have some quality dialogue about this issue, and not a bunch of sound bites being generated for whatever press agency wants to cover this affair. With regard to the question that Mr. Lashley posed to Laura Roselle, well before 287G was implemented, I started studying the economic impact of Hispanics on the county, because I was impressed with the high levels, occupancy rates for private property and also as well as commercial property in the county. I come from the city of Detroit, where I can tell you what happens when people move out and nobody moves in. In the case, I conducted a study, and I came up with a result that I believe I shared with you all in an email about a month and a half ago. I emailed it to all the members of the commission, and in that report I claimed, and this claim is subject to disproof, that we experienced roughly double an increase in housing values from 1990 to 2000. This is across the board, and most of the increase occurred in middle and upper middle class homes, not in the working class homes. We experienced double the increase in value of properties and you can calculate the consequences of that increase on county revenues. Now, if you implement a program on the federal level to extract this population from the county, then I think I will put this question to you in paper. I want to know what your response is to the homeowners of this county when real estate values start decelerating at a rate greater than they're decelerating because of the shenanigans that were played by the mortgage industry over the past few years. And by the way, Sheriff, regarding the enforcement of all laws, how many of the sheriff deputies have been given special training to track down IRS cheats, cheating on your taxes against the law? Do you have specialists to do that?
We don't have training to do that. We're not.
Okay. How many? The Security and Exchange Commission will tell you that all sorts of turbulence has been introduced. I'm a business professor. All sorts of turbulence was introduced into our securities markets. How many of your deputies have been given special training to track down the mortgage brokers and the bankers who gave loans under false pretenses to citizens of this county? You said, and many of the commissioners said, that we have to enforce the law. We can't make exceptions. Well, from my perspective, what this local police agency has done is chosen immigration for special attention and special training, when the real things that are hurting us are being cast aside. Maybe they're too complicated. I suggest that our priorities are wrong. Thank you very much.
Okay. Next is, thank you. Next is Richard Johnson.
First, I'd like
thank you all for listening to me, because I sometimes have a strained relationship with some members of the commission, and it really does say something that you all are willing to listen. I'd also like to thank Mr. Lashley for asking his question, because I was a little bit nervous until you asked that question. I'm not nervous anymore. First, let me ask my questions. I used to be a magistrate in Charlotte, and the way we did it in Charlotte, this is back in the 80s, so it's probably changed a bit. Person was arrested on the street, had to be brought before me or another magistrate, because we decided probable cause. Was there enough probable cause to actually charge the person? If we charged, then they were turned over to the jail for fingerprinting, because sometimes we found no probable cause. This wasn't because the police are incompetent, but the laws are very complicated. To operate on the street is very complicated. And I, on a few occasions, not many, but on some occasions, I would find no probable cause. I had to do that on a police officer I grew up with who was in Boy Scouts with me, and it was hard telling him, I'm sorry, Hal, but there's no probable cause. We don't do it this way. My fear is, are we seeing people getting arrested on the street who are being printed and put in 287G before probable cause is found, and then because they're already in 287G, the pressure is pretty much there, you need to go ahead and charge this guy. And I'm not going to claim, because I don't believe the police would go out and drum up charges, but when you're on the street, according to the officers I knew back when I was a magistrate, it's often a judgment call. Do I arrest this guy or not? And it's often, do I have probable cause to arrest him? Well, now it's something different. Is this guy possibly an illegal alien I'm going to nail? So what I'm asking is, are we sometimes arresting people who would not be arrested otherwise? I believe people should go by the law. So if I go out fishing in the hall, I guess I'll be deported. I guess I'll be sent back to my, separated from my family. I guess I'll lose my house. I guess I'll lose my car, because I'm going to be treated like everyone else, like those five men. Here are my questions. Since persons arrested in Alamance County are fingerprinted prior to the determination of probable cause by a magistrate, is that possibly resulting in people being arrested on charges that are later found to lack probable cause? Secondly, is the rate of conviction on original arrest charges of those persons later processed under 287G higher, lower, or equal to the rate of those not processed under 287G? Another question. Are the names of all persons held in Alamance County under 287G program being released to the press and the public so that the community can be aware of whom has been apprehended, or must specific inquiry be made as regards to each detainee? In other words, if people are being held and no one knows it, your neighbor disappears and you don't know why. Turns out he's locked up, or your daughter, or your best friend. And my last one, given the aggressive stance of law enforcement in Alamance County towards undocumented aliens, to what extent are we seeing reluctance among members of the immigrant community, both documented and undocumented, to cooperate with police by providing information on dangerous illegal activity in their neighborhoods? In other words, has a situation arisen in which people who would otherwise cooperate and even seek out law enforcement assistance instead avoid law enforcement for fear that their immigration status, or if they're here legally, the status of friends or neighbors might be discovered, and then they'll be deported? Also, one last point. I'm sure Madison Taylor will be thrilled to find out his paper is actually the record, the legal official record of answers from you commissioners. So if I guess I will never read a misquote. Anything that's printed there, put my hand on the Bible, it must be true.
Or what's written in the blogs.
That's true, too. Yeah, and you and I know that more than anyone, I think, as does Jack Nimble. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you. We do have a question. Okay. I was going to let it slide. You have been a magistrate.
Yes, sir.
I've been a police officer.
Okay.
And you write, you have to make judgments. Mm-hmm. When you make judgments, mm-hmm. are you going to say that just because they're here illegal and they commit a crime, you're going to turn them loose?
No.
What is it that you people want? Do you want us to, do you want the sheriff and the police officers?
My grandmother always told me, when someone asks a question, wait for the answer.
Okay. I was justifying.
Okay, let me make sure I understand your question. Are you suggesting we're saying if they're illegal, they should be released for other crimes they're committing?
That's what it sounds like to me.
Well, okay, well, I'm glad you asked that, because that's not what we're saying. If a person is a drug dealer, not only lock them up, but when they finish their sentence, ship them out. If a person's a rapist, do it. If a person assaults my 16-year-old daughter, do it. If someone steals my car. But if a guy is fishing in the Hall River without a license, if the guy gets a no-operator's license ticket like I got when I moved to this state because I waited too long to get my new license, no, you don't throw them out of the country. Because you're, look at Marjavi, breaking up her family. Her husband's locked up in Georgia for months, losing everything she worked for. And this was an honor student who went to UNC, who would have worked for this county and done great things in her life. Instead, we're throwing her out. That's a great investment. Yeah, let's invest in this kid's public school. She becomes one of us. She goes to one of our finest universities. Now let's throw her talents out. That makes no sense. We're not saying if a person is a lawbreaker, you let them get away with it. We're saying that the idea that someone coming here illegally, the way some of our ancestors might have, is not the same as someone shooting me, burning down my house, stealing my car, or dealing drugs. And that's what we're saying. So no, we are not saying release the criminals. We're saying these people have stumbled over a law that we all admit is completely screwed up. Y'all all agree the immigration statutes are really screwed up. So those are the ones you're going to pick to really put your emphasis on? I think you'd say, hey, these are screwed up. Let's back off a little bit until Congress can do their job and solve the problem.
Do you think the 600 workers that were arrested or rounded up in Mississippi, that should have been ignored?
I'm not aware of that individual case.
Oh, my goodness. It's the biggest roundup in the country's history, and you don't know about it?
I'll put it this way. I don't believe in roundups in America. I don't believe in going out there and saying, because an individual business owner decided you were the best person to hire, I don't believe in that kind of roundup.
That was hardly the case. You need to study that.
I'll ask you to
tell me, give me an answer back. Do you think those 600 workers who took jobs from people who they had applications on file? And
the answer is no. I don't think they should have been rounded up.
They should have just been left there to work?
Yes, left there to work.
Well, the American people don't agree with you. 80% of the American people or better do not agree with you.
What percentage do you think in 1957 in the South said we need to leave these segregation statutes?
Well, we're talking about illegal immigration.
We're talking about the morality of laws.
Okay, I don't want to debate you any further because you know my position. It is not changing. I haven't blinked an eye in 10 years on this, and I'm not going to blink an eye. Y'all showed up after 10 years of us investigating this issue, studying this issue, and you're desperate. You are desperate. And if we were the only county in the United States out of 3,000 and some odd counties that was putting a foot down on this, I could probably have some second thoughts about it.
Well, I'll tell you who's desperate. Marjavi's child is desperate.
Well, I'm sorry. I didn't put them in that predicament. Now, I'd like to ask the
She didn't put herself in that predicament
Sir,
either.
Sir, I've had enough of you. I think you've had enough of me. Okay.
Well, I'll say this. My mind is not closed. Mine's not closed. You just said you would never change your mind.
I have studied it enough to...
I apologize, Mr. Short. Yeah, I agree.
This is going nowhere.
You're right, sir. I apologize. Homeland Security doesn't agree with you.
I guess he's a kook, too.
Let me apologize, Mr. Short. I shouldn't have gotten so upset. I meant everything I said, but I should have said it in a calmer way.
Now, I'd like to ask the political science professor one question, please.
I apologize for getting upset.
I'd like to ask the political science professor a question, please. Now, you're in political science. You teach it.
Yes, sir.
Okay. I would assume that you support full and open access to the political system. Pro or con to your position or my position. Full access. You didn't show up tonight with this mass without networking.
I don't believe I would characterize this as a mass.
Okay.
I would characterize it as community members.
But it was networking, clearly. Okay, and I have nothing wrong with that. You're accessing the avenues of political involvement on issues that you hold firmly on, okay? You didn't call us. You didn't have to have our permission.
I sent you an email 10 days ago to which you never responded.
About what?
About asking you about the meeting.
Well, I have no intention of informing you. Forgive me.
Oh, excuse me, but why?
Why should I?
At the last county commissioners meeting, you said, I watched it on television.
Well, and I'm going to.
And you said you were going to the meeting and you encouraged other people to come.
I don't.
You said, I hope you're all there. So I took you up on that and sent you an email. You never responded to me.
Well, let me tell you where the meeting will be. A week?
I know now.
5 days. Okay, I hope you're there. It is a public meeting. And to insinuate, you didn't insinuate, well, you fairly well insinuated, that it's a hate group sponsoring. Now, would you like to name this hate group?
The group is FAIR, called FAIR. And to my mind, that is a hate group.
You're against illegal immigration.
So, and we actually don't need to have this debate here, but if you would answer my emails, perhaps we could
have... I had no intentions of answering your
emails. We could have a conversation about this, where you were maybe trying to be open-minded about this, so that
only open if I'm on your terms.
I'm willing to listen to you. Mm-hmm. I've done research. You can ask Mr. Engel how open-minded I am. You can ask him.
We've heard how open-minded you are.
Mr. Engel?
Political science, I'm sure that you're that open in your classes too, aren't you?
She taught me in political science at Elon, and she's a tough professor. She was very good.
I had tough professors too.
So I think that, you know, what part of this is about being open-minded to and with each other. And I know that you feel very strongly. I know that Mr. Lashley feels very strongly on this issue. But there needs to be a way not to do what we did.
It's called the election.
In William County.
Is what it's
because
called.
Because it really did get very nasty.
Don't you think Prince William County officials are going to be able to testify as to whether
they're testifying to one side. What I'm asking you to do is to talk to people who don't agree with you, so that I reached out to you, and what did I get? Nothing back. So
I've been
in
this for 10 years. You're just another voice. I'm sorry.
Well, thank you.
You're another voice. I've heard this debate for 10 years. Do I have to listen to everybody on a one-on-one basis?
You're an elected official. You're supposed to listen to the people.
Well, I'm hearing you. But you stood up here tonight and insinuated that I'm going to a meeting Friday sponsored by a hate group. And that's absurd coming from a political science professor.
Okay. Look, if you're willing to be open-minded and to work with people in the community on this, we are willing to work with you and to have some kind of workshop. You can bring your people. You know, but there are other sides to the story.
And we've gone over the bridge. Why? You know.
Okay, that's not the way our country works. It's not, Mr. Sutton, made a decision, and now I don't care what anybody else has to say. That's not the way we
run.
But
do you think that
community.
We're supposed to go back and undo what we've taken 10 years to accomplish?
I think you're supposed to say, okay, you know what?
You I'm just don't agree with us.
This is what I think you're supposed to do. I think you're supposed to say, look, all right, there are these community members. They have a problem. They have some issues. Let me sit down and really honestly see what the issues are. And to the degree possible, work with them to either disabuse them of things that factually, okay, they're wrong about. Maybe you have evidence. We don't know. I mean, that's part of the problem.
That's fine. I haven't.
Okay?
I'll be quiet. I know Larry wants to move on. But I have heard nothing tonight that bothers me about any of the inquiries except your insinuation that the meeting we're going to Friday is sponsored by a hate group, and you know that it's not. That's not so, and you should know if you know anything about FAIR. Frankly, I didn't know FAIR was in, what is it, Civitas?
I'm not referring to Civitas in when I say that.
Well, I certainly wouldn't consider FAIR. Do you consider the Center for Immigration Studies in Washington a hate group?
I don't, but they certainly are partisan, extremely partisan, and they only have one point of view.
What about the Cato? What about the Cato Institute?
Mr. Sutton.
The Cato Institute is on the other side of the debate, and Center for Immigration Studies is over here. Cato's okay in your eyes, but the Center for Immigration Studies is
but
not.
Now you're putting words in my mouth.
I'm just asking you good debate questions. You can't say.
You're asking and then answering your own debate questions.
Well, is Cato not as partisan on the issue of illegal immigration as the Center for Immigration Studies?
On this issue, it's a very complicated situation because there are not two sides to this issue. There are multiple sides to this issue. Cato and Civitas are on different sides of the issue. However, there are multiple other groups because there are more libertarian groups who say the federal government should not be coming into local communities.
They believe in open borders, too.
And so that you have varied. All I'm saying is that among all of these different perspectives, or you should be open to listening to them and not be so quick to say, you know what, I'm just not going to listen to the citizens or a group of citizens, when we could actually do something together to ameliorate, to help. I mean, people are scared. There are people in our community who are scared and who are hurt. And that's the thing that really gets to me most, that in dismissing us so quickly,
I want to say one more thing.
About
with all due respect, you don't know what's in my heart.
See your actions, though.
You don't know what's in my heart. You hear words. You hear words.
Yes, sir.
I've laid in bed at night before praying that my involvement on this issue has not been inconsiderate, past the way we're supposed to manage a nation when you have to make a decision. Just within the last few weeks, I've had concerns about people who do have that lost look on their face, children who might not know their future, parents who might not know their future, and so forth in our community. And it's tough. And if you think I've sat back, popped a cool one out of the refrigerator and grinned every time something positive on my side of the debate happens, you're sadly mistaken. It's been tough for me. But I took a stand on something. I studied it, I researched it, and with my convictions, I took a stand. I don't sit back and say, whoop it, and celebrate. Mm-hmm. This is a tough, it's like going to war.
It's tough. It is tough. And I appreciate your comments on that. I really do.
But I'm serious about it.
It's tough. All I'm asking you is
don't prejudge me.
And please don't prejudge me either. Because I think that if you keep your mind open and you're willing to have a conversation, that there's ways to make life better for all of the community. That's all I'm saying.
I'll listen
Thank
to
you.
Anything.
See, it's world politics, I believe.
Comparative politics.
I'll try to think. It's been a while.
I'd like to say one thing, if I may. I know I've received emails from several of you, Mr. Newhouse, Mr. Johnson, Ms. Posehill. My days have been long and hard and running constantly. It's not just been 5 days a week. It's been 7 days a week. I will get around, bear with me, to answering those emails. Leaving early in the morning and getting home late at night and then checking to see, oh yeah, I see that, I read that. Being able to even respond was like too much. But I will get around to it, and if you'll just be patient, I will answer your emails, please.
Thank you, Ms. Vaughn.
Mm-hmm. And we will record all the questions. We have recorded all the questions tonight and try to get answers out on the website if they can be answered in that fashion. Okay, we'll close the public hearing now. We'll go next to the public hearing on the schedule of values for the reevaluation. Who's Mr. Manager? Who's doing that?
Jim's here.
Okay.
That's administrative.
Richard.
Yeah, bless you. You get both sides. Bless you. Don't bless you.
I don't have a sign-up sheet. Is there anyone here who'd like to speak on the schedule values?
This is a public hearing on the schedule of values for the reevaluation that will be effective next year. It's been advertised. Is anyone in the audience like to speak on this? Okay.
If not, I will be before the board again on October 6th.
Thank you. Next, the detention facility emergency security
repair. I think we need a motion to accept the schedule of values, Mr. Chairman.
Move. I thought we were going to do that on the 6th.
Right. We have it scheduled 2 weeks after the public hearing to bring it before the board for their approval on the acceptance.
The lady's open again.
Yes, sir. Thank you.
Okay. Major Rich.
Good evening, and thank you for letting me talk to you. I've got a presentation there. Before we get to that, I did send you a memorandum And after I explain to you what our situation is, I've asked you to declare basically an emergency over to the jail, which will allow us to not have to go through the bidding process. And the reason for that is we're either going to have to close down, we've been told, or get this repair done very fast, or we're going to end up in a big jam, I guess you'd say. We're talking about the East or Old Jail. I call it East Jail, but it's the Old Jail. It was built in 1985. It's been in use, of course, 24 hours a day for more than 22 years. And I'm going to read it to you, so, and I know you can read, but it's easier for me to go that way. And the security system that's in the Old Jail is a design that requires a staffing of what we call satellites, or control rooms where officers are supposed to be stationed to visually observe inmates at all times. They have not been staffed due to lack of manpower since the building's first day of operation. And I've been there since 92, and we've only staffed it probably for 3 to 4 months, and that was in 2006. When it was staffed, the system dramatically cut down on assaults and damage to the building. I mean, a lot. It cut down a lot on it. That system, which is, I'm going to show you some problems with it here in a minute, was slated to be replaced at the same time as the jail addition was being built, and it was going to cost more than $500,000 at that time. It was going to include cameras, new door controls to open them, close them. I didn't put it in here, but turn on the lights, turn them off. Intercoms also for two-way communication between the officers and the inmates. The jail inspector came in February of this year, and in their report they referenced that the East Jail security system needed to be replaced. And they saw some of the things that I'm getting ready to see, show to you. And we just were inspected again on September 3rd, and the chief jail inspector came this time. And he noted the same condition. But the difference in this inspection and all the rest of what we've ever had is he wrote a letter that basically said you're going to close down or staff it or do the repairs. And he didn't give us much time to do it in either. There's 10 additional areas of the East Jail that have to be staffed, put a man in there, or you can put cameras and two-way communication in there. To put 10 more officers on a shift, which would probably require 45 more officers, nobody wants to hire that many more. We can't afford to do that. You can count up the money, and that's a lot of money. So our best bet is to put the cameras, the intercoms, and the new system in my opinion. Of course, we've had to bring in extra officers and pay them overtime just to be able to operate now, not counting the new system that we need to replace. And once he told us we had to man the 10 satellites, it's been a problem. We haven't been able to do it. We can't do it. You'd have to bring in two shifts and work them 24 hours a day. And we've struggled. If we're forced to shut down the East Jail, which he is threatening us with, we'll have to move inmates to other facilities, and it will cost a lot. Just to move them, we have to pay them to keep them, and we'll lose the revenue that we're making right now, which is significant. And there's the letter that John Harkins wrote to the sheriff, and if I don't know if you can read it or not, but basically what it's saying is what I've told you. We need cameras, we need two-way communication, or we need to have somebody staffing those satellites. Do you need to see it any longer, or do you have it? Okay. There's an example. That is the control board, control one in the East Jail, and you can see there's some light flashes there, but anyway, you've got holes there. We've had to cover it up with paper and tape and label it. This is where we've just used it constantly. You're hitting it with your fingers, you're touching it, and it's a hard plastic covering. You can't get it any longer. And we have some doors and cell doors that actually show open sometimes when they're closed, or vice versa. And we've had some problems with that. We've had doors open on their own, and we didn't push any buttons. And we're still having problems with that. There's another example. That's the control one second floor door where we push the door. If I want to walk up the steps and I don't have a key, I can push the door and then get into the second floor door. And we've wore that button out pretty good. And it's a stairwell door. Again, the board covers cannot be purchased or replaced. There's another example. That's the buttons for the kitchen. This is all in first floor control still. That's probably the worst board we have. That's the control two on the second floor of the East Jail. and you've got at least four holes there that need to be, you just can't do anything with them. You can't tell what they are. We have to write little notes and stuff beside it, and you can just see it's in a horrible condition. It's also the intercom control. And there's our intercom. And I know I'm asking you to give us the money to put an intercom in, so you may have the question why you've already got it. What that is, and of course it's worn out, that's an intercom, but it's not true two-way intercom system. We can call into the cells when it's working, but they can't call us. They can talk to us as long as we allow them to, and that doesn't suffice for detention standards. And that's been in there since day one. That's another example of the board there, wear and tear. That's a satellite. That's where you can also open doors and turn lights on. That's a big board, probably bigger than this that I'm standing at right here. And we've also got wear and tear on there. And some of those lights don't work. You can't tell which doors are open. And it's hard to get replaced and repaired. We've had electrical fires, of course, broken components. Lack of replacement parts has been a big problem. The system is antiquated. We don't have cameras, we don't have two-way communication, and so we saw this and we started to replace the security systems as we could, starting on the third floor East Jail. And we spent some money there out of our budget, and I think the county has helped us out on that too. But we've gotten to the point now where we can't do it piecemeal. It's gotten too big, what we've got left. We contracted with Fleischer at that time, they're out of Elon or Ossipee, and we had great difficulty getting vendors to even give us a quote. Fleischer has been able to work on the stuff, and we have not been able to get anybody else to do it. That's an example of a new system that Fleischer puts in. That's on our third floor. And it's a lot, it's as small, as big as this paper maybe. It's a computer screen. You can touch it with your fingers. You can use a mouse on your computer. It's just much better. It's light years ahead of what we've got now. And there's what Fleischer has quoted to us. You've got, when it says station there, I think that's computers. You got seven computers, 132 light controls, 142 door controls, 10 stairwell door controls, 31 intercoms, 20 cameras. So it's a lot. It's a big scope. And I can explain that to you. But basically what that is, that's the first floor. We have one control there, and you have two blocks. And you also have a medical holding, and you've got some doors that you have to open. All that's basically showing you what kind of equipment he's going to put in there, if we allow him to do it. Cameras, doors, controls, lights, intercoms. Same for the second floor. Of course, it's bigger there. In addition to the main control room in the middle, you also have four of the satellites I told you about that you can open doors and turn lights on and use intercoms. That's different than the first floor. So, in other words, you don't have to sit in the first floor and not be able to see what you're doing. You can actually go and see what you're doing through the windows and open the doors and be able to do it that way. Third floor is, of course, smaller, and he's basically replaced most of that. We don't have intercoms or cameras right now, but they're going to replace that. But we do have some Fleischer equipment up there now, and it works great. The addition of cameras, and I'll read this to you, will allow us to more closely monitor prisoners, help us curtail inmate assaults. We do have a problem with inmate assaults. You probably read it in the paper. We see the aftermath of the assaults. We rarely ever see who does it. Sometimes they don't tell us. Sometimes they do when they're making bond. Oh, yeah, I got beat up, and it was Joe Blow. And it's hard to make a case afterward. But they don't want to tell on each other. I think they're threatened, maybe their family, what have you. And it costs the county a lot of money to pay. We've had some broken jaws, whatever. I mean, you can just dream up anything, and it's all happened there. You got inmate-on-inmate assaults mostly. The two-way intercom system will allow us to comply with the state rules. It will also be safer. If an inmate's having a medical emergency, they don't have to beat on the bars and us try to figure out where they're at. They can call us and tell us. And we do have that in the new jail, and it works great. Of course, I think the most important part of it all, the staff and the inmates will be safer and more secure. And right now, we do have a problem with our system, big time. Do you have any questions?
Yes.
I know you do.
Major.
Yes.
When we built the new detention center, I remember very distinctly it was in the plans to have the security system and the fire alarm system, is that correct, all done at the same time, that, you know, for the old jail as well as the new detention center. evidently the security system was not done.
Right.
But the fire alarm system was.
It was.
Well, whose brainstorm was it that took out the detention, the security system?
I know this is going to sound like I'm making up an excuse, well, but I really don't
you.
Know.
Yeah, I'm not
and
asking
I would
you.
Have to give you conjecture, so I'm not going to say it. I really don't know. I just know that it was cut out.
Let me add right here. That, it was part of the expense and the money that was borrowed to build a new jail was to also fix the old jail. That money was cut out before I became manager. I don't have any idea who cut it out or when it was cut out, but it was cut out.
Did you not have the opportunity to review that, David?
I did not. I was not in on the planning of the
No,
of
I'm
the
talking
new
about before you ever turned the keys over to the sheriff.
We've had this problem since the original jail was built, 22, 23 years. The same people, maybe not the same individuals, but the same inspectors have come in and looked at this, and they have seen it for years and years and years. This problem is indicative of the problems that we are facing and that you have decided to solve, in that so many of the buildings we have been neglected. This jail over here, nothing had been done to it since it was built, the old jail. And now we are having to pay. You know, in the military, you have all kinds of maintenance that you do all the time, periodic maintenance. And
it should
hasn't
have been
done in this county. I'm sorry.
But I just toured
and
that.
It's going to cost us more to get it done now, but it's got to be done. The sheriff here has to bring in $6 million for the budget this year. And if they close down this part of the jail, which is going to be how many beds, Major?
That would be 156, possibly.
It's going to be impossible to meet the budget. I mean, it's just something that has to be done. I'm sorry.
Okay, I just toured the jail in that old section, and what I saw was absolutely terrible. Mm-hmm. The security, even your security, the men's security, is lacking, and we're waiting for something really bad to happen and waiting for a lawsuit.
We've been lucky.
Can this be paid through what you're taking in? I don't know if it's $6 million. I think that's gross, maybe $2 million, maybe more like that. Can this be paid with those funds, Sheriff?
What? I've talked with the sheriff and I've talked with the major. We've got about $10,000 to $15,000, $20,000 remaining in the facilities fund that y'all set up. I think the bid is
221,000.
So we've got to come up with about $100,000. And if the board will give Amy and I the go ahead, we will find that money some way. And hopefully the sheriff will bring in more than the $6 million that's designated in the budget. And that money can be used to replenish where we take it from now to get the jail fixed and brought up to standards.
You can take it out of travel.
any money he makes on the jail, man, goes back into the fund balance. And so, I mean, you know, that's where it would come from. It would come out of the fund balance.
But just like this year, Commissioner, the sheriff brought in more than he was budgeted to bring in. And I think If this part of the jail remains open, he will probably bring in more than $6 million. He's already applying to increase the per bed per day amount that is paid, and I think eventually that will be raised. So it's just a maintenance problem, and it could be a lot more expensive than it is. When I first got involved in it, I think we had a quote of $60,000. That was for one floor. And I just cannot continue to piecemeal put things back together when we need to get it done completely. So we went out for more bids. And it's hard to get bids on this because there are very few companies who do it. And most of them are from out of state. And I think we found out from the past, when you use companies from out of state, it's hard to get them in here for repairs. It's hard to get them in here to do anything.
Right, well, I understand this Fletcher Industrial Controls has got an Elon, and they can be here right away, and it's easier to, for your people to fix something. If it goes wrong, it's easier to understand.
It is. And they've helped us on repairs already to the old system that we just couldn't get anybody else to fix.
And comparing this price with what was on that sheet that I had, and I'm sorry, I forgot it.
That's fine. I got it right here. $567,000.
Exactly, and this is less than half of that.
That's
so.
The only silver lining I see in it. It did say we're spending less money this time.
Exactly, and that's a good thing. Do we need a motion? I'll move.
The board needs to declare this an emergency, and I quite frankly
exactly
think
right.
This is an emergency.
Exactly right. And I'll so move.
Second. Okay, any further discussion? Not all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All opposed? Motion carries.
Thank you,
Major.
Very much.
Next, we have finance matters. We have three budget amendments. The first one is for judicial services.
Gary Cole was not able to be here tonight, but this budget amendment number 26 for $3,409 is to add additional funds from the NC Department of Corrections for the Criminal Justice Partnership Grant Program. And this is 100% state funds, and it does not require any county funds.
Okay. I have a motion to approve.
So moved.
Second.
Second. Any discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Motion carries. Okay, the second amendment for the health department. Amy, you want to handle that one?
I think we pulled that one, Mr. Sharp. That was for a grant, and the way they issued the grant, we were not able to get that money. So that one, we need to just pull that one.
Okay. Next is the budget amendment for social services.
There's about five or six, so I'll go through them pretty quickly. The first one, number 29, is some additional money from the Piedmont Natural Gas Share the Warmth that will help out with some heated-related emergencies this fall. It's an addition of $798. Number 30 is some leak crisis administration money that allows us to determine eligibility for usually elderly and families who are having trouble with heating-related emergencies. Number 31 is a decrease, actually, in our crisis intervention money. That's concerning to us with the economy and the cold winter that's predicted. But we usually have a state of emergency by the president, and we usually get additional funds. So that's a decrease of $77,000. Work First Demonstration Grant, we received an additional $7,000 to work locally, 100% state money to help put folks to work. And then we received an additional $44,000 in our domestic violence grant to help with domestic violence services in our community, and an additional $202,000 in our daycare subsidy. Basically, these are cleaning up the budget estimates that we received in February, and the General Assembly passed the budget in July. I'll be glad to answer any questions.
Of course, emergency funding for energy.
Yes, sir.
Have we got any left now? Anything?
We do. We have some left, and we currently have community services that determines eligibility and allocates those funds. So there is money left, and we usually get regular. We hope to get a couple more deposits of that, but right now we do have some funds.
Thank
you. Can we approve all those at the same time? I'll make the motion that we approve them all.
Second.
Any further discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Motion carries. Thanks for memo, Susan, too, on the $2.3 million returned to the county.
Yeah. We were glad to do that this year.
That's great.
Plan to continue the fiscally conservative.
It's always good to get some back, isn't it?
Yes, sir. We do our best.
Thank you for the job you're doing, Susan. Thank you.
Good job, Susan.
Okay, next, Mr. Manager.
The only thing I have is in I've provided you tonight with an editorial from the Greensboro News Record concerning the Family Justice Center that you approved last week, and they are actually complimenting you on your ideas for doing that. That's all I have.
Yep.
I think that's the first mistake, wasn't it?
It is, yes. Yeah. There's one other county, I think, who also in the name also.
Wake County.
Wake County.
Okay, on the consent agenda, we have a motion to approve items A, B, C, D, and E.
Motion.
Second. Second. Any discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. Any commissioners have any announcements?
I've been very concerned about several things that we had passed. One was the employees' benefit policy and the travel policy. I would like for us to revisit, not tonight, but revisit the employee benefit policy. It's going to be very hurtful to this county. Let me just take, I'm going to use the sheriff's area as an example. If this is allowed to stand, he could lose, or it's going to affect, I believe it was 67 deputies or people in the sheriff's department and something like 72 in the jail, that this would directly affect. And I'm picking on you because it is a tough department and it's hard to get people. I would like for folks, if we can at a later time come back and address this issue on, it's the medical benefits that we had passed.
The medical plan or the?
Well, when people hired after a certain date, it was presented about a month ago, hired after a certain date, when they retire, they will not get medical benefits.
The new hires. They wouldn't.
But the others will also be affected because there's some change and some shift in that direction also.
No, there's no change. It's only those people hired after, as of July 1 this past summer, and there's not a 60-some in the jail or 50-some in the sheriff's department. There are very few. Everybody who was on the program as of June 30 stays on the program. It's new hires.
Okay, but the benefits were cut.
No, the benefits were not cut. And that was in the budget ordinance. It wasn't passed individually. That was in the budget ordinance.
Yeah, I went back and found it.
Yeah.
I missed it.
No benefits have been cut. I think what has happened is the switchover from the way we were doing it to where we directly pay, I think, Social Security for those who are on Medicare. There may have been some confusion on that, but the benefits are still the same.
It wasn't cut as far as you being here so many years, a certain length of time?
No.
Okay, no medical benefits after a certain date, hired after a certain date.
As of July 1, no
08.
No retiree medical benefits.
Exactly.
Right.
So isn't that like asking people to be loyal to us for 20 years or more and then kicking them to the curb?
No, they come to work knowing they're not going to get it.
But are they going to stay?
Well, I don't know any other companies around here who do it, quite frankly.
That's our problem. We're not a company.
Yeah. But the other counties, and I tried to go back, and I was kind of rushed. That's why I'm asking.
A lot of counties and cities are getting out of that because we're paying $1.5 million a year now out of our budget for retiree medical coverage. Now, you want to go 5 or 10 years down the road, you're going to have $3 million or $4 million or $5 million, and that's how many more cents on your tax rate? When most private industry does not provide, they had to get out of it. They can't afford it.
It was an ever increasing unfunded liability for the county, and I think the county made a wise move in taking that step now, because it would have been it's a huge liability now, and it's just growing larger every year, and the manager's right. There's very few, if any, private industries that offer a retiree health insurance. This is something state government does, and some counties do, and maybe the federal government. But you don't find that out in the public sector anymore.
Well, David, do we have anything that even a percentage from the time they retire until they pick up Medicare?
We got a 401k.
they can save it in the 401k.
Well, there are several benefits there. I'm just really concerned about medical, because when you retire, that's when you need it probably. The older you get, the more you turn to it.
Are you talking about they retire before they're 65?
Yes.
And if, no, there's no bridge after those hired after July 1.
Is there any way we can fix that bridge? I mean, on a percentage basis.
But it was my opinion that it's getting just too expensive, and in the future it's going to be even more expensive. And
there are some, I know municipalities, Elon, town of Elon, a retiree, they don't pay their medical insurance, but they can sign on with to stay on with, you know, and get it at a cheaper rate because they're in that group. In that group, and that's something that maybe we could look at. Because of the pool, you know, the size of the pool, they can sign on and pay that rate, and that way it would be cheaper for them because they wouldn't be retiring. That's something, and that we could probably look at.
I think Cobra has that.
Yeah, you can certainly, that can certainly be done where they could pay their amount. But we, as far as I know, and the new HR director will be here Monday, but I don't know of any employees we've lost because we didn't have that benefit to offer them since July 1.
But we're really talking about the future, and health insurance individually is terribly, terribly expensive that a retiree would be hard-pressed to afford it. So if we can have some kind of a bridge, letting them check into that.
Yeah, we lost a good recruitment tool. I mean, you know, when
absolutely.
That's one thing that
this is something y'all would need to do for the next budget year. It's something you wouldn't do in the middle of a year like
that's right.
this.
Yeah.
That's it. You're talking about expensive venture there. Any other announcements? Okay. Meet adjourned. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you. Doors in, they could pay. They could pay the same.
Thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners meeting. Meetings of the Commissioners Board occur on the first and third Monday of each month in the Commissioners' Chambers on the second floor of the County Office Building located at 124 West Elm Street in Graham. Typically, the first meeting of the month is held at 9 a.m. and the second meeting is held at 7 p.m. Changes to the meeting schedule will be posted on the Commissioner's website at www.alamance-nc.com. You can watch the most recent meeting of the Commissioners on the second and fourth Friday of each month on Time Warner's local public access channel beginning at 3 p.m. You can also watch recordings of the most recent meeting and past meetings by going to our website at www.alamance-nc.com. Please visit our website for more information on watching Commissioner meetings online. For technical questions about this meeting's online or television broadcast, please contact our county webmaster at webmaster@alamance-nc.com. Please note that this address is for technical questions only. Questions or comments regarding the content of Commissioner meetings may be made to the Commissioners themselves. You can find their contact information at the Alamance County website at www.alamance-nc.com. Click on the link that says County Commissioners to visit the Commissioners' website, where you can learn about our Commissioners, read minutes of past meetings, access agendas, and find other information about our Board of Commissioners. You can also send mail correspondence to the County Commissioners by addressing it to the Alamance County Commissioners, 124 West Elm Street, Graham, North Carolina, 27253. Again, thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners meeting.